Hang on. I'll be right with you. I just have to write a letter.
Dear Jeff Zuckerman and the other one. Dear Jeff Zuckerman and Ben Silverman. You are the two guys that run NBC. Now, you probably know that, but the audience didn't, so I thought I would let them know.
Can you shut up? I'm writing a letter.
Anyway, I'll tell you why I'm writing this letter to you. Because I think you might be losing your minds. I mean, first of all, you cancelled Jay Leno, who, come on, he's America's cheeky late-night monkey guy. Then you go one worse. This is what will make you burn in hell forever, you bastards. You cancelled Lipstick Jungle. You bastards! That's right, I said it. Bastards! Lipstick Jungle is a great show. Brooke Shields is on that show, and I felt her bum at the Emmys. It was the greatest day of my life. I think you should reconsider your action, and in protest, all Lipstick Jungle fans should send their lipstick to NBC. Ha! I'll be sending mine. When you get 300 sticks of Crimson Pirate, you'll know just how I feel.
You're Stevie's Craig Ferguson. Get out in the mail. Welcome back to the show. All right.
Gentlemen, Craig Ferguson.
Hey! You too? You look nice. Come on in. Welcome to Los Angeles, California. Welcome to the Late Night Show. I am your host, TV's Craig Ferguson. Please. All right, that's enough.
Yes, thank you.
That's enough. All right. Please. No. That's enough. Quietly. That's enough. Let it go. Let it go. Look, if you overdo it, it starts to sound a little insincere. Also, if you applaud and cheer and think I'm great and I haven't done anything, people will think I'm Barack Obama. I've done it yet. Hey. It's a great day for America, everybody. Great day for James Bond. The new James Bond movie took $70 million at the weekend. I know. A buff Englishman hasn't made that much money in America since Madonna's last tour. We live in a material world, and I am a material girl. Get off me, Barra! Do you remember that in the late night television we used to laugh at Lindsay Lohan? Do you remember Lindsay Lohan? Well, she was attacked by anti-fur activists in Paris. She must have been wearing fur. But they hit her with a bag of flour. She was furious. She got halfway through snorting it before she realised it wasn't okay. She was outraged. Now, listen to me this, if you listen to nothing now. According to literary agents in New York City, Sarah Palin is about to sign a $7 million book deal. I know. They didn't say whether it's the right one or read one, but she's going to sign it. And she is not ruling out the idea of running for the Senate in 2010. She's already formed a committee to explain to her what the Senate is, so it's looking that way. And... Craig, you made fun of Barack Obama and Sarah Palin. That's right. I'm an immigrant. I am. Still an American. Now, Penthouse Magazine is opening a casino in Las Vegas. Isn't that awesome? Ah, I bet a lot of guys can't wait to go there, play poker, and then maybe play some cards after that. All right, that's enough. Cut that out. That's disgusting, that joke. Who put that joke in there? Oh, yeah, I'm the only one here. Never mind. We're having very bad wildfires in Southern California. It's scary. One burned 2,000 acres near Santa Barbara. It even threatened Oprah's house. Oprah's house! Don't worry, Oprah was not in danger. She turned on her force field and the fire... and the fire went away ashamed of itself. Because... No, don't. Don't now. Sorry, Oprah. That's right. Fires talk like Scooby-Doo. Sorry, Oprah. But you know what Oprah did, apparently? She put up all her pets at the Four Seasons Hotel. And boy, was Stedman glad when she picked him up the next day. He was running in little circles, chasing his tail. And like, oh, yeah! Now, last night on the 60 Minutes, you watch the 60 Minutes on CBS? I love it, especially Andy Rooney. But... 60 Minutes had Barack Obama on, and it's the highest ratings they've had in 9 years. I think Obama's the youngest person they've had on the show in 9 years. But... And today Obama met with John McCain, which was terribly sad, because McCain couldn't remember who he was. But...
Do you want a shiny new penny?
He's old, you see. I know, this is not particularly funny, but I'm mean. Anyway, here's the thing I want to talk to you about. Is that it's a great day for Paul McCartney, because they have found an old Beatles song. He found it. I don't know where he found it. Probably, you know, back down the sofa or something. But it's a Beatles song that no one's ever heard, and he's going to release it. It's a new Beatles song. It's amazing. And Paul's very happy. Do we have a picture of Paul? There he is. Now, the lost Beatles track... He's still the cute one. The lost Beatles track is called Carnival of Light, and it's 14 minutes long. And supposedly it's experimental. Now, when musicians say that something is experimental, they mean it's crap. Apparently, the song is... It's 14 minutes of the Beatles banging around in the studio, pianos, hitting drums, random sounds. You know, you hear someone gargling, there's a parrot somewhere. I think Ringo takes a pee. You can tell it's Ringo taking a pee because it's out of tune. Oh, stop it. Knock it off. That's no way to talk about a Beatle. Who? If I find out who put that joke in there...
I'd like to be taking a pee.
I'm not sure about this song. I love the Beatles. I love the Beatles. Everybody knows that. I had Ringo on here. We did a whole show about Ringo when he was here. But the last time the Beatles put a lost track, it was Free as a Bird. It was crap. The surviving Beatles at the time recorded new music around an old John Lennon vocal, and it sounded like they just found his old answering machine message or something. I was like,
leave a message at the beep, 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 yeah.
This is not a new thing, though, you know, recovering lost songs. I mean, it happens all the time. Tupac still puts out 3 albums a year, for God's sake. It doesn't have to slow you down being dead now. With the technology, they can cut a musician into a modern track. Elvis had a big hit a couple of years ago. Can't remember what it was, but he had one. It was,
my humps, my humps. My gravy has some lumps. Thank you very much.
What I'm saying is they do it all the time. You know, they bring out the Elvis Presley, there's Nat King Cole, even Beethoven. When Beethoven died, he left scraps of an unfinished symphony, and other people tried to finish it. But it never works, because you can always tell which part is Beethoven and which part is the other guy, because it goes, da-da-da-dum, da-da-da-da-da-da. Now, what I'm saying is, that some musicians don't know when to stop, is what I'm saying. I mean, I think the Beatles' legacy should be left intact. It's fantastic. It could not be bettered. I mean, you're just going to get... Like, I saw The Who, right, in the late 70s on their farewell tour. This year they went on their 38th farewell tour. These are the guys that sang, I hope I die before I get old. Now they've got, they're singing the theme tune for CSI. They got the, who am I? Who?
No, seriously, I don't know. Do you want a shiny new penny?
All right, we'll take a break. We'll be right back with the show. Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back. Welcome back to the big show. I don't have time to be mucking around tonight. We got a lot to get through tonight. There's lots to be done. We got nothing. Do we have time for an email?
Yes, Greg, there's time. So up in your mind for a magical ride on email.
I've got blisters on my fingers.
That is a previously unreleased Beatles track. I'd like my 20 million bucks, please. All right, let's see what we got here tonight. This is from Janine in North Hollywood in California. I love it in North Hollywood. It's like Hollywood, but a little colder. It actually is, and it's got moose, and it's near Canada. Anyway, Janine says, Dear Craig, I'm sorry to inform you that Lipstick Jungle has been cancelled by NBC. Look! Wow! Are you okay? Do you need a hug? No, I do not need a hug. I don't think it's been cancelled yet. Not officially cancelled. I think you send in your lipstick to NBC and say, hey, you know, because remember Jericho on CBS when CBS cancelled it and then everyone sent in their peanuts and then they cancelled it again? Take that, customer. All right, this is from Rusty in Statesville in North Carolina. Rusty says, I'm stationed in Iraq. Okay, you're in Iraq. He's going to Scotland for R&R. Do you recommend staying in hostels or not? I don't know if you want to go to Scotland for your R&R. You've been stationed in Iraq. You might want to look for something a little less violent. What about France or something? Yeah, they got cheese and stuff. France should have that on their tourist brochure. France, we've got cheese and stuff. So, you know, I mean, come on. All right. Mm-hmm. This is from Kayleen in Shakopee in Minnesota. Shakopee. Kayleen says, Hi, Craig. Do airbags hurt when they hit your face? I know you find this hard to believe, but I have actually never been hit in the face with an airbag. Well, not an airbag that was in a car. Let me set the scene for you. They were playing Black Velvet, diddle-dee-dee-dee-dee, and then, oh, never mind. Anyway, suffice to say, it didn't hurt. In fact, I rather enjoyed it. Now, as I think about it, I might do it again. This is from, I don't know, it's anonymous. So we don't normally read out the anonymous emails. And I'll make no exception tonight. All right, this is from Pietra in San Francisco. Pietra's one of those names. You don't know if it's a man or a lady, really. Actually, that's not true. San Francisco is one of those towns where you don't know if it's a man or a lady. Pietra is a lady's name, clearly. But in San Francisco, maybe not. Pietra says, Dear Craig, do Murphy's Law and the Luck of the Irish cancel each other out? I'm Scottish. Plus, we don't all know each other, you know. Also, I don't know. What is Murphy's Law? Is that anything that can bad happen will bad happen?
Anything that can but happen will but happen. France, we've got cheese and stuff.
What's the other one? With Murphy's Law and the other one, Luck of the Irish. Luck of the Irish is what, some kind of advertising thing for Lucky Charms? I don't really understand that. I know a lot. Actually, half of my family are Irish, not particularly lucky side of the family. I may have said too much. Oh, we're out of time? All right, let's sell some stuff and we'll be right back. We'll be right back, everybody. Welcome back. Now, this is a very important show for us tonight because it is over the weekend, Prince Charles celebrated his 60th birthday. I'm not making it up, he did! And he had a party at his country house with a performance by Rod Stewart. I know. I wonder what that was like. Isn't this a lovely party? You've got the presents and the balloons and there's a little bit of cake. Not very many people, though. I kind of wish I hadn't beheaded all of my friends. Even my wife Camilla didn't come. That's all right. We'll have a good time, won't we, huh?
Surprise!
Oh, good Lord! Oh, dear God, Camilla! Oh, Lord. What on earth?
Here I am!
Yeah, I see. Oh, darling, you look lovely. What on earth are you doing in that giant pastry besides getting me hot?
I wanted to do something special for your birthday. I thought I might spice things up.
Well, you know I like it spicy.
This party's thumping.
Yeah, exactly. The only thing that would make this better is if I were king.
Darling, for that to happen, your mother would have to die.
Exactly. Have my sons, the princes, arrived?
Well, they showed up drunk, ran someone down in the parking lot, and they're wearing Nazi costumes.
Oh, they're delightful, aren't they, little rascals? Thank you for my party, darling. Now, who's my special musical guest? Is it the Jonas Brothers, Liza Minnelli, or the Jonas Brothers, or Madonna, or the Jonas Brothers?
Someone even better.
The Jonas Brothers?
Close. Rod Stewart.
Rod Stewart? We can't afford that kind of top-notch family entertainment. How much does Rod Stewart cost?
Well, it depends what you want. He normally gets £1 million, but for an extra 20, he'll do anything you want.
I want him to cover me in butter during the guitar solo and Hot Legs.
Oh, here's Rod Stewart now.
Is it? Oh, yeah, that is. Hello. Whoa. Whoa. My Lord. He's a wild man.
I'm Rod Stewart, bitch.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think there's something wrong with Rod Stewart.
Yes, I know, and he's much taller.
It's all right, dear.
Yeah, it's all right. Sorry, I got something stuck in my teeth. You know, Rod Stewart, that Rod Stewart, he's taller than I expected.
Even taller, yes. Yeah.
You know, there's a song that he sings. There's a song that he sings, Rod Stewart, you know, that always makes me think of you.
Do you think I'm sexy?
No. It's actually an obscure song from his first album. It's called You Look Like a Horse.
Charles, you're so romantic.
doing today? Guess earlier on today, I was doing some promos for CBS. And what they do is, like, you know these little things they put together at all the different shows? And I had to do this. And, hey, then catch me. It won't make it onto the air, but they let me do it to make me feel part of things. But you will never see it. My first guest stars on Without a Trace, which is Tuesday nights, right here on CBS at 10 o'clock. Take a look at this.
If Rob was feeling guilty and went on a bender, I can't find any proof of it in his financial records.
You know, it would be so much easier for us to solve cases if drug dealers would just accept credit cards.
Yes. I'm going to check around. I'm going to see if anyone saw anything that made them think he was falling off the wagon.
Samantha, are you doing anything tonight? I thought that I would, pick up some Chinese and come over.
I told you my mom was in town all week to see the baby, right?
Yes, you did. I've just been in denial about it.
Please welcome the lovely Poppy Montgomery, everybody. Poppy, you look sensational.
Thank
you. I mean, just say, look at you with your dress and your hair and all the other stuff. No, you look very, very well.
I'm in my,
That's the question.
I've been working really hard since I had my baby.
You had a baby. How is your baby?
He's gorgeous.
Oh, lovely.
He's big and beautiful.
I'm surprised to hear you say that, because sometimes new mothers go, oh, he's a pain in the ass. I'd rather not. But you do like him, then.
I'm in love with him.
Oh, great.
I mean, which is not going to be good for him when he's 16, but it's good now. He's going to be like, get off me, weird lady.
Yeah, no, you'll change your mind a little bit as time goes on as well. Well, you won't stop loving him. No, you won't stop loving him, but he will start to smell differently.
Oh, I don't know if he could smell any worse than the diaper I opened. Yeah. Ooh. If he smells like that at 16, he's got problems.
No. Now, listen, when did you have the baby? Because you look like you're...
Well, he's 10 months old, and I gained 70 pounds with my pregnancy.
Wow.
Yes. I was having a Haagen-Dazs baby.
Yeah.
Along with the real one.
70 pounds?
70 pounds, but I really...
How much did the baby weigh?
Seven.
63 pounds of you?
I thought the baby was going to be one of those big 12-pounders. And he wasn't. He was very small. Petite, in fact.
Right. 7 pounds is in the neighborhood, isn't it? It's about average.
Yeah, like 7.5 pounds. Yeah. And then there was 63 pounds of...
Things to
love.
Deal with, yeah. So how did you get in shape? Did you starve yourself? Believe
me?
No.
I started with a number of things. Look how I just answered that like it's a normal question.
But it's Hollywood. No, believe me. I know that's so last year.
Yeah. No, the first thing I did was I wanted to feel sexy with my weight on me. So I tried to lose it by being sexy, and I took this pole dancing class.
I am very, very happy in the way this conversation is going. You took a pole dancing class?
I took a stripper pole dancing class.
Stripper pole dancing,
you say? It was terrible.
It was terrible?
Well, here's what happened. First of all, I'm afraid of heights.
You're afraid of heights?
So climbing the pole was kind of a problem.
Oh, you don't have to go that high up the pole. I mean, what are we talking about? 2 or 3 feet?
Well, there was a grandma in the class with me. There were lots of different women.
Stop. I don't like the direction we're going in now.
She was better on the pole than I was.
Well, she's got more experience on the pole. She's a grandma. Knock it off, you filthy-minded bastard. They have a class where all the girls go and they...
Right, like, so you go to feel empowered, and it's about women
empowered.
Empowered?
What, yes. You get a dollar every time you...
No, you sort of... You love your body, you stroke your body. Like, there's a lot of self-love going on, and then you jump on the pole. You literally run at that thing, jump, grab it, and you're supposed to swing around.
I am all about this. I need to lose some weight. Let's do it.
No, but I got bruised shins, and I'm not that good with the pole.
Right. Well,
I had a problem with. I mean, no, wait. Hang on.
Yeah.
I'm not that good with the stripper pole in the strip dancing class. I was a little uncoordinated with it.
Do you know, I once, very long time ago, went to a strip club. I know it seems insane, but it was in Australia.
Oh, which one?
Which one? You know them. It was... it was the big Australia next to the little New Zealand. It was the... It was in Adelaide. The Crazy Horse Striptease Saloon in Adelaide. I had my 25th birthday party there.
Striptease Saloon?
That's what it was called,
Adelaide's like the tiniest, most wholesome place. I can't believe they have a strip club.
There's a little pocket of CD. They got a little pocket of CD right there, and I found it.
I went to strip clubs in Sydney.
Do you really? Do you go to strip clubs?
I've always secretly wanted to be a stripper.
Well, let's get a pole in here, for God's sake.
No, listen, I'm not good at it.
Oh, right, okay. Yeah. Wow. Why do you think? Because I think a lot of girls would question that who were.
Well, no, because there's some. I mean, first of all, having done the class, I learned. That it's a real skill, the dancing that they do.
Oh, I certainly.
I mean, it's required.
To me, it's like watching sport.
But it is. It's like ballet. It requires enormous strength and coordination, apparently none of which I possess.
Right, you gave it a good old college try, and that's what counts.
I did, yeah. But when the granny beat me in the class, I knew it was time to leave. I was like, when the granny's upside down, swiveling down the pole...
When the granny beats you, it's time to leave the strip club. Are you going to take your little boy to Australia? Has he been to Australia yet?
We're going this Christmas.
Oh, really? So he'll be a year?
He's a year on December 23rd.
Right.
I'm trying to make a really big deal out of his birthday because it's right before Christmas Eve.
Right.
We're going to have a big party in Australia. Lots of alcohol for the adults.
Yeah, well, it's Australia.
A petting zoo for the kids. Yeah, it's going to be like a big, wild party that my mom's throwing there for him.
It's Australia. It is a big, wild party.
That's true, the whole country is.
It's a very good, fun place to go, isn't
it?
I haven't been in such a long time. And, you know, I think it was talking about this Crazy Horse Striptease Saloon in Adelaide's really got me thinking I should go back.
I'll go with you.
Really?
Yeah, they have amateur nights at some strip club.
I think every night is amateur night in the Crazy Horse. I think it's all right. And some of the guys get up there, too. You've got to keep
in
shape.
I wouldn't get up there, obviously, but I would get up. I would watch you.
I'm okay with
it. Yicky, oh, yicky, don't. Yicky, yicky.
Have you toured around Australia? Have you had a look around? It's a fascinating place, you know. You probably just stayed in Sydney and was all, you know, cosmopolitan.
No, I've been to, mostly Sydney, actually.
Right, yeah.
No, I wanted to go to Ayers Rock.
Ayers Rock. We can't call it Ayers Rock anymore. It's called Uluru now.
Is it really?
Yep. Ayers Rock is a colonial name that was given to it by the British, but it doesn't belong to the British. It belongs to the Aboriginal people who live there, so it's called Uluru.
Did they actually officially change the name?
I did. I was told that by... Do you know a guy called Ernie Dingo? He's Australian. He's a stand-up comedian.
Yeah, I know Ernie Dingo.
See, they do all know each other.
Yeah.
Ernie is an Aboriginal, and he told me that it's called Uluru, not Ayers Rock.
I really wanted to go to Uluru.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
But I didn't get there. I almost got to the Barrier Reef, the Great Barrier Reef.
Yeah, no, as opposed to the not-so-great Barrier Reef. The crap Barrier Reef.
Yeah. The not-good Barrier Reef.
And then just the reef. It's not even a barrier. It's just, you know, it's just an old pram lying in the water.
No. Yes, well, I didn't get there. And I've been to Melbourne.
Well, that's nice. Melbourne's lovely. You know, there's a lot. They got trams in Melbourne.
Yeah, kind of like San Francisco.
A little bit. Well, they have a lot of ding, ding, ding in San Francisco as well. Nothing to do with the trams.
No, that's the noise that the bell makes on the
tram. That's right. That's ding, the ding, noise ding. That the bell makes. I know. We're out of time. Listen, Bobby Montgomery, everybody. It's lovely to see you. We'll be right back. I'm reading. Hmm.
Yes, reading. I still do it, even although I'm no longer officially European. Is that reading something like Game Boy? It's a little like Game Boy, yes. My next guest is the author of the book that I am reading. It's called Slam. It's out in paperback now. Please welcome this guy, Nick Hornby. Nick Hornby, everybody.
Three years?
You
must have just started.
I did. I just started. You were one of my first guests, I believe. You'd written a book that, then, too?
Yeah, I think that the people who were on in your first few weeks got invited back as a courtesy.
Always, yes.
Because you were so bad.
I was terrible, yes. Very, very bad.
I owe those guys.
So different. How are you? Are you still living in England?
I'm still.
All right,
unlike
then,
a lot
if you
of
insist.
People.
Now, the. The book is called Slam. Now, it's about teenage pregnancy, is that right?
It is.
Were you
it
pregnant
is.
As a teenager? Did you?
I was.
No. Really? Did you have...
No. It's about two 16-year-olds who are on the verge of having a baby. It's narrated by the dad.
The dad? How did you get the idea of the dad talking about?
Well, it was seeing a young couple in my neighbourhood, and... we have a lot of teenage mums living near me, but you don't often see.
How do you see these people? Do you use binoculars out your window? Or
I'm afraid I'm always in the park with them.
You're in the park? Are you in the park?
With my own kids.
Oh, right. Well, fair enough. Yeah. Your own kids. Hired for the occasion.
Yeah, they're a good friend. And there was a 16-year-old boy pushing a buggy, and I thought, I don't know so much about the dads. You read quite a lot about the mums, and it interested me.
Did you find out a lot about young fathers? My father was very young, I think, when my older sister was born.
When you say, I think, you ever asked
I don't know.
Him, no interest in how old he was.
No, I think people used to have their kids very young, didn't they? I mean, what age were you when you had your kids?
35, my friend.
Right, that's terribly young.
It's terribly young. I wasn't ready to give it all up.
I was nearly 39 when my son was born. I want more. Do you want more?
No, I got three.
No, oh, you want to have an even number, though, don't you?
No. I really don't. I got three
boys.
Oh,
no, I have another one. Really?
I shall pass that on to my wife.
Right, yeah.
Craig would like me to have
Yeah, you guys
baby.
Have another...
Yes.
To what age are your kids now?
Well, I got a 15-year-old, and then I've got a 5 and a 4.
Now, the teenagers, what are they into now, the 15-year-olds?
He watches football a bit, but I my 15-year-old is autistic.
And, right. I'm not quite sure what that means. I know it's difficult, but I don't know what it is.
Well, autism is a severe communication difficulty. So
right.
He doesn't speak. He makes himself understood
right.
through various ways. They're cunning little devils, autistic
right.
kids, because he chooses, it seems to us, not to speak, but he's found a way of communicating the need for crisps, biscuits, television.
Pretty much a normal teenager to me, by saying it.
Yeah, it's teenagerdom reduced to the bare bones.
Yeah.
Pretty
well,
much.
If you're writing a book about teenagers, how do you research this then legally?
I'll tell you about the other bit later.
Please don't. But how do you go about researching a book like that? Do you talk to teenagers?
I talk to teenagers. I've got nieces and nephews and friends of the family. You can read a lot of stuff online because quite a lot of the internet.
You can actually pose as a teenager online.
Yes,
I do that often.
As a teenager online. Do you remember that Scottish guy who went to school? I don't mean that. No.
A Scottish guy went to school. I don't know about that. Let me phone someone. I think we should do it. We should fact check this. He's saying a Scottish guy went to school. Now, what are you talking about?
There's a big statue of him in Edinburgh, in the centre of Edinburgh. The Scottish guy went to school.
Yeah. The wee Scottish boy that went to school.
No, there was the 25-year-old. Who
really?
Went back to school, posed as a...
Posed as a teenager?
Yeah, and he was called Brandon Lee. He'd called himself
Brandon Lee
after the film,
right,
film star.
Yeah.
And he was there for weeks and weeks before anyone rumbled him.
I don't think the teachers could be paying attention.
I was thinking of that. Yeah. Anyway, I was thinking, could I pass
as a teenager?
Yeah. I got the shaved head. I got the...
I have no wish to be unkind.
No, well, don't.
I'm not going to. I think you could pass.
Remember,
as a
teenager. I came when you just started.
Yeah,
don't
that's
be
true.
Unkind,
yeah. Put a nickel for every time I heard that. I am. People are. I lose my patience sometimes. Now, so you talked to some teenagers, you found out about this, and you wrote a book about teenage
pregnancy.
Well, the
hard thing for me was writing about skateboarding, because this kid's a skateboarder, and he talks to a poster of Tony Hawk, and Tony Hawk talks back.
He's been here.
Tony.
Tony Hawk has been here on the show, and he actually does talk back.
Even to you.
Even to me. No, and this is the kind of figure of...
Yeah, I use Tony Hawk's autobiography. He only talks back in lines from his own autobiography, so he's somewhat limited in how he can respond.
Of course, you are clever, aren't you?
Thank you. Yeah. I try.
That is clever.
So Tony Hawk's autobiography becomes kind of like the I Ching. You know, the kid can open it and read some words of wisdom on any page. And he was very kind, Tony Hawk. I asked his... half the book for me.
Yeah. That's really smart.
You whittled down the words, because last time I was here, you were a Scottish chat show host, yeah. And now you're an American author.
That's right, yes, I am.
You're like John Updike.
I'm not really, not like an author like you. I'm a guy who wrote a book, you're an author.
But anyway, getting someone else to write it, you'll appreciate you whittled down the
words. That's a good idea. Did you attempt skateboarding yourself at any point?
I was given a skateboard on my 50th birthday by my agent when I just finished that book, and within, I'd say, a minute and a half, I'd done myself some fearsome damage. Never touched
They're
it
really
again.
Hard.
Really hard.
I don't know how kids
really
can do
hard.
It. It's like a plank of wood with a wobbly thing underneath.
Yeah. They look reasonably secure,
they
but they're
look
not.
Bad.
They're
yeah,
not.
But they're
not
terrible.
At all.
Yeah. Curse you, young
and
people.
And I don't think they're for British people.
They're not for British people. We like good, firm things to stand
exactly.
on. Comfortable shoes and a nice piece of ground. Well, thank you.
Well, we have enough trouble with that.
Yeah, yeah.
Any town centre on a Saturday night.
It's true. Good time.
You don't want to put the wheels underneath, too.
We got to go. Nick Hornby, everybody. We'll be right back. I like the cow. We've had some lame stuff because we had the kitten for ages, and then we had some lame. We had a duck. That wasn't that good, you know. But the cow's good. You'll see more of the cow. May do the whole show with the cow tomorrow night, actually. I mean, come on, it can't get any worse, can it? Let's bring a cow in. You'll never see it. We can't light the damn place anyway. I've said too much. All right, what did we learn on the show tonight? We learned that... we learned that NBC have maybe cancelled Lipstick Jungle, but if we send them all our lipstick, they might not cancel it. They'll cancel it. We also learned that in France they have cheese and stuff. We learned that fires are fires talk like Scooby-Doo. And we also learned Poppy Montgomery not so good on the pole, apparently. I think that's just that bit of that self-deprecation. I'm sure she's fine. Anyway, that's all. I guess we'll be back tomorrow night with a cow, everybody. Good night.